We have a distinguished speaker tonight, Dr. Michael Waldstein, who is in town this week conducting a workshop for the John Paul II Forum on the theology of the body. And we've been working through some of the text of John Paul II and looking at the philosophical sources. And I did think it would be good to have Dr. Waldstein give an evening lecture bringing together some of the ideas that he's worked on in the philosophy of Pope John Paul II, Blessed John Paul II. He really is in a unique position, I think, to come to the study of John Paul II. He's studied both phenomenology, the thought of Thomas Aquinas. He's worked with Cardinal Schönborn and done work on Vatican II. And I think he really has worked out some remarkable insights into the thought of Blessed John Paul II, how he has really followed a deliberate design of education and writing over his whole career, involving the study of John of the Cross, Schaller, Thomas Aquinas, and has come to see the need to bring together faith and reason, to have a philosophy consonant with the Word of God. That's one of the great lines of Fides et Ratio. And so this lecture tonight, Dr. Waldstein said he would like to go through these sources that John Paul has used to develop his philosophical positions about the human person and God, but in particular to look at how Gaudium et Spes, that document on the church in the modern world, was a document that John Paul worked on as Cardinal Wojtyła during the Vatican Council. And it came to serve as a touchstone document as he developed his thinking for theology of the body, certainly, we've been seeing over the last couple days, but also for his overall philosophical development. So Dr. Waldstein got his undergraduate degree at Thomas Aquinas College and then went to the University of Dallas to get his PhD, where he worked on the thought of Hans Urs von Balthasar. He also did a thesis on Bultmann at the Harvard Divinity School, and he is now a professor at Ave Maria University. He probably has another unique distinction that he passed up a tenured position at Notre Dame to start a theological institute in Austria. So he is a man of great breadth and great keen interest in both philosophy and theology. And so I am honored to present him tonight to speak about John Paul II and phenomenology. Dr. Waldstein.
A generous introduction. John Paul hasn't been received with equal alacrity among all Thomists. I don't know how it was here in Houston at the Center for Thomistic Studies, but among the tutors of Thomas Aquinas College, where I studied, the enthusiasm for him was mild. And they were wondering, what is God's providence doing here? I remember the first time I lectured about John Paul II there, I began with a story about John Calvin. John Calvin was playing golf with a Dominican priest, and as they teed off, John Calvin hit the ball beautifully down the fairway, but the Dominican priest hit the roots of the grass and said, "Damn it, I missed." And John Calvin just, "You mustn't curse. That's against the law of God. You can't do that. God will punish you." So they get further on, and the same situation again, and the Dominican says, damn it, I missed. John Calvin says, I warned you. If you do this once again, I'm going to have to call on God to punish you. And it happens a third time. And he says, damn it, I missed. And John Calvin spreads out his arms and calls on God to punish the priest, and a cloud comes up, a dark cloud, and a lightning strikes out of the cloud and kills John Calvin. And out of the cloud comes a mighty voice, damn it, I missed. That was the impression many of my tutors had, that in the election of John Paul II, the Holy Spirit missed. Damn it. The impression given by some commentators at the beginning of John Paul II's pontificate was that here was somebody who, in a way, attempted to combine classical Thomistic ontology, the philosophy of being, and the philosophy of consciousness, as he had inherited it, this was the common view, from Max Scheler, the phenomenologist on whom he wrote his habilitation thesis. Much of the sensitivity of John Paul II for experience, in particular, for how things are given in our experience, was attributed to his study of Max Scheler. After studying him now for about 15 years, I'm working still on a book about the sources of the theology of the body. It's close to being finished. I've become convinced that this construal of John Paul II as combining phenomenology together with certain Kantian elements and classical Thomistic metaphysics is a mistaken view of the intellectual configuration of John Paul II. The more exact view, if one looks both at his biography and at the actual content of his writing, the more exact view is to put St. John of the Cross in the foreground. Karol Wojtyła had an intense sensibility for the beautiful. And that came out already very early when he was a high school student and acted in a number of plays. He was very much attracted by poetry. In his first year as a student of Polish literature at the university in Kraków, he encountered the writings of St. John of the Cross through a man, Jan Tyranowski, who was deeply imbued with the teaching of St. John of the Cross. He lived a single life, in some ways a Carmelite life, without being in a Carmelite monastery. And he introduced him to the writings of St. John of the Cross. Karol Wojtyła was so fascinated, so attracted by those writings, that he immediately learned Spanish to read St. John of the Cross in the original. And that was before he entered the clandestine seminary at the Archbishop's residence in Kraków. 7 years later, he wrote a dissertation under Reginald Garrigou-Lagrange on St. John of the Cross, on faith in St. John of the Cross. Unfortunately, well, I can understand why he wrote on faith. Had he written on love, the situation would be a lot clearer. But he wrote on faith, and so it's a bit tricky to weave together the evidence. But the fundamental argument that can be made seems to me this, that St. John of the Cross was intensely interested in the actual experience of being a Christian, of what it actually means to be a Christian, what takes place within us, in our conscious life, in our perception of ourselves. That was the focus of his attention. And he developed what takes place within us thematically in terms of content, mainly in light of the Song of Songs. When St. John of the Cross died and his confreres were reading the usual prayers for the dead, he waved them aside and said, no. Read me from the Song of Songs. That's what I want to hear for the moment of death. John of the Cross had a thorough Thomistic training at the University of Salamanca, where the great Thomistic renewal was taking place. The Salmanticenses, the Carmelites, who commented on the Summa, that's considered one of the best commentaries on the Summa. So John of the Cross had St. Thomas intus within him. By encountering John of the Cross as a young man, Karol Wojtyła encountered St. Thomas in a particular form, namely, immediately with a sense of the whole. That is, he didn't study with this and that and that and that and that neo-scholastic handbook, but with a vision of the whole provided by St. John of the Cross that gave him, in some ways, perhaps a more connatural contact with St. Thomas as a saint, within which then his Thomistic training took root. That seems to me very important. He was not a run-of-the-mill neo-Thomist. But when he encountered the first neo-Thomist tractates when he entered the seminary, he was fascinated by them. He was fascinated by the discipline of concepts and absorbed all of that. What then, I think, explains, John mentioned there's a certain logic to the development of Wojtyła. I think that's very true. When he then later encountered the philosophy of consciousness, when he came to know the philosophy of consciousness, especially Kant and Scheler, he was able to think about them from a perspective in which the aspect of consciousness had already been deeply explored. It was not new territory for him. If you look at modernity as a whole, the modern age as a whole, you can say that the Carmelite renewal in Spain in the late 15 and then the 1600s was, in a way, an authentic Catholic response to the Reformation, in particular to Luther. It was a stream of modern thought with this particular penchant that we have in modernity for subjectivity, for paying attention to what occurs in the conscious life of the person. Of course, Augustine in the Confessions has that richly, but nevertheless, it is, generally speaking, a feature of the modern age. So that was, you could say, an authentically Catholic stream of modernity 50 years before Descartes. The manner in which the philosophy of consciousness developed in Descartes 50 years later was quite different. What I want to do is compare three opposite types of personalism. That of John Paul II, together with John of the Cross, which one could call a Trinitarian personalism of self-gift. Then secondly, Immanuel Kant, which one could call an anti-Trinitarian personalism of autonomy. And finally, Max Scheler, whose personalism one can call, using his own terms, a theomorphic personalism of solidarity. And I want to point out the similarities, but also the profound differences. Kant and Scheler were the principal partners in philosophical dialogue that what they were engaged in, so the choice of those two is kind of natural. And Scheler was one of the most virulent opponents of Kant. But as often happens when you have a favorite opponent, you become more like your opponent than you think and wish. There's a passage in which John Paul II defines personalism by appeal to Gaudium et Spes 24:3. In the seminar, I mentioned that in my classes on John Paul II, I tell my students right at the beginning of the semester, if you want an A in this course, it's very simple. Whatever question I will ask you on the final exam, answer it the same way, namely, Gaudium et Spes 24:3. That's the correct answer in every single case. You don't need to know anything apart from that. It's very easy to remember, 24:3. But of course, you'll have to explain why that's the answer. So here is what John Paul II says. In the hymn to love, in the first letter to the Corinthians, we receive the Magna Carta of the civilization of love. In this concept, 1 Corinthians 13 is, I will show you, this after Paul talks about the charisms, I will show you a greater way. And then comes the way of love. In this concept, what is important is the radical acceptance of the understanding of man as a person who finds himself by making a sincere gift of self. A gift is obviously for others. This is the most important dimension of the civilization of love. We thus come to the very heart of the gospel truth about freedom. Freedom cannot be understood as a license to do anything absolutely. It means a gift of self. Freedom means the gift of self. Even more, it means an interior discipline of the gift. The idea of gift contains not only the free initiative of the subject, but also the aspect of duty. All this is made real in the communion of persons. Continuing this line of thought, we also come upon the antithesis between individualism and personalism. Love, the civilization of love, is bound up with personalism. Why? Why with personalism? And why does individualism threaten the civilization of love? We find a key to answering this in the Council's expression, a sincere gift, Gaudium et Spes 24:3. In his Theology of the Body, Pope John Paul quotes Gaudium et Spes many, many times and in key places. For example, he says that Gaudium et Spes 24:3 explains why the human body has a spousal meaning. This is from Theology of the Body 15:5, talk number 15, paragraph 5. One can understand this spousal meaning of the human body only in the context of the person. The body has a spousal meaning because the human person, as the Council says, is a creature that God willed for its own sake, and that at the same time cannot fully find himself except through the gift of self. And that's simply a quote of Gaudium et Spes 24:3. Why does the body have a spousal meaning? Gaudium et Spes 24:3. So if that answer comes up, if that question comes up in the final exam, why does your body have a spousal meaning? 24:3. A. So based on these texts and many others like them, one can define John Paul II's personalism as a personalism of the sincere gift of self in accord with Gaudium et Spes 24:3. That is, a personalism rooted in the union of persons in the Trinity and Christ's gift of his life for us. It's not surprising, therefore, that he calls the theological method of his Theology of the Body a hermeneutics of the gift, because gift is the key term in Gaudium et Spes 24:3. It's a comprehensive interpretation of reality, of the human body, but many other realities, in terms of gift. And the hermeneutics of gift is, of course, a hermeneutics of receptivity and communion. Gift and reception are correlative, and communion is their fruit. So let's take a look at Gaudium et Spes 24:3. If my students memorize it, all of them have to memorize it. It's the first thing I ask them on the final exam. Please recite Gaudium et Spes 24:3. So I guess I have it here on the reliable part of my brain, but I will try it off of this part of the brain. The Lord Jesus, when he prays to the Father that all may be one as we are one, the as is very important, one as we are one, thereby opening vistas closed to human reason, indicates a certain likeness between the union of divine persons and the union of God's sons in truth and love. That's the first sentence. This likeness shows that, and now come two principles, that man, who is the only creature on earth God willed for itself, now comes the second, can only find himself in a sincere gift of self. See Luke 17:35, where you read, the one who makes his life secure, the Greek word there is peripoieo, that is, who does things around his life, like a fence. So the one who makes his life secure will lose it, and the one who loses his life will make it live. Zoogonese, that will make it live, yeah. In Matthew, the saying has the form, the one who finds his life loses it, and the one who loses his life for my sake finds it. So it's a reference to the cross, very clearly. See, the text begins with the Trinity and ends with the cross, as in the sign of the cross, when we say in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and when we combine these two fundamental points of Christian life. My reliable brain tells me it was an accurate quote as far as I... At several points in, not only in the theology of the body, but also in other writings, John Paul says that this text contains the whole truth about the human person. That's a lot to say. The whole truth about the human person. Now, to see a whole in its integrity, you have to see its beginning, you have to see its end without ignoring the middle, then you see the whole. And those two laws in Gaudium et Spes 24:3 are related to each other somewhat in that way, as beginning and end, but they cover the middle as well. Let's begin with the first one. God willed man for his own sake. The only creature on earth God willed for itself. In other words, God wills the good for us. Does that mean that God doesn't will the good for trees? Well, of course God wills the good for trees, because he looks at the whole he has created and says, it's very good. But being a good tree doesn't do a good tree much good, because it can't appreciate that it is a good tree. The goodness of it in some way bypasses it. It's objectively a good tree, but the tree doesn't possess its own goodness, and therefore you can't wish it well. Walk up to a tree and say, have a good day. And the tree says nothing. Yeah. Except if it's on another planet in the solar, not our solar system, but Aristotle touches on this principle in his Ethics when he writes, of the love of lifeless objects, we do not use the word friendship, for it is not mutual love, nor is there a wishing of good to the other, for it would surely be ridiculous to wish wine well. If one wishes anything for it, it is that it may keep, so that one may have it oneself. But to a friend, we say we ought to wish what is good for his sake. And St. Thomas in the Contra Gentiles says that God provides for creatures whose nature gives them the power of intellectual knowledge and will for their own sake. Quote, divine providence provides for intellectual creatures for their own sake, but for other creatures for the sake of these. Only the intellectual creature is therefore sought for itself in the universe, but all other things for its sake. And again, the reason is the rational nature, that only somebody who understands and loves the good can really possess it. This is what Wojtyla calls the personalistic norm, that when you face a person, the norm is we need to wish that person well, will them for their own sake, as God willed them for their own sake. You can't just use them as a means. Now, to see the power of that norm in establishing an integral vision of the person, that is the whole truth about the person, you have to see it in relationship to the commandment of love. In Love and Responsibility, Wojtyla writes, this norm in its negative aspect states that the person is the kind of good which does not admit of mere use, and cannot be treated as an object of use and as such as a means to an end. In certain ways it can, but the point is not just. In its positive form, the personalistic norm confirms this. The person is a good toward which the only proper and adequate attitude is love. Now, in the teaching of Jesus, you have the commandment, you shall love your neighbor as yourself, which sums up the whole law. For this is the law and the prophets, the love of God and the love of neighbor, both. So the moral life as a whole becomes intelligible through this one commandment. Augustine writes, Dilige et quod vis fac. Love and then do what you want. In that way, the personalistic norm is indeed a royal highway to understanding the whole truth about the person. But it's not the whole truth. It's the beginning. It's a principle that arises from our nature. Everyone has this dignity. Every person who is a person has this dignity of being able to grasp the good, and therefore we are to will the good for their sake. The second principle cannot fully find himself except through a sincere gift of self. That doesn't concern the beginning, but the end of the life of persons, we could say. Fully finding oneself refers to completion or perfection. And perfection needs to be acquired and is fully acquired only at the end. The argument given in Gaudium et Spes 24:3 for this second law of the life of persons is a strictly theological argument. In his prayer to the Father, that they may be one as we are one, Jesus shows a similarity between the union of divine persons and the union of human persons. And it's that similarity between the Trinitarian and the human communion of persons that shows the truth of the law of the gift. That's the argument in the text. And the council insists very clearly on the newness of the revelation brought by Jesus when it says he opens up vistas closed to human reason. He opens up the unheard of heart of God's inner life. It may well be that giving and finding is reflected also in the natural order. But Gaudium et Spes doesn't draw attention to this fact, but places us immediately in the innermost sanctuary of Trinitarian theology. In one of his works, Wertheimer writes, love as uncreated gift is part of the inner mystery of God and is the very nucleus of theology. I do think there are also philosophical analogs to this law of the gift. There are above all two metaphysical principles that have played an important role throughout the history of metaphysics. One of them, an Aristotelian principle, in the Meteorology, in the fourth book, when Aristotle discusses weather, as you would expect him to in a meteorology, he asks, what weather do you need for fruit to ripen? And he talks about that back and forth, and then asks, well, how do you tell when fruit is ripe? It's kind of an incidental question for the weather, but he answers, fruit is ripe when it can produce another of its kind. And then he adds, kind of as an offhand remark, but it's quite amazing, for this is what we mean by perfection also in every other case. Now, St. Thomas recognizes in that seemingly stray remark a metaphysical principle of the first order, and he applies it in an astonishing variety of contexts. One context is in De Potentia, when he asks whether there is generative power in God. He says, what is in act, acts and communicates itself. For, as the philosopher says in the fourth book of the Meteorology, this is what we mean by perfection in every case. Therefore, there is communication in God. God communicates the fullness of his being. It's not a philosophical demonstration of the Trinity. He makes that clear, but it makes it plausible. The second principle that has played a big role in the whole of metaphysics is bonum diffusivum sui, which the medievals usually derive from Dionysius the Areopagite. And that principle, too, gets applied across a broad range of phenomena, including Trinitarian theology. In several arguments, you find this in Bonaventure and in St. Thomas. St. Bonaventure and St. Thomas, I don't know. Give them equally the title. They use it to make plausible that within God there is communication. Gaudium et Spes 24:3 just briefly alludes to the Trinity by the phrase, as we are one, and in the phrase, union of divine persons. And according to the text, that example or the paradigm of the Trinity has a lot to do with Christ. As we are one, that shows, since we are our union as human beings, just between husband and wife, is like that, that we find ourselves in the gift of self, and then comes the saying of Jesus about losing one's life. So there's a connection between the gift that takes place in the Trinity and the gift that takes place on the cross, and our participation in the cross. Marriage as a crucifixion. But that's not extraordinary. All of life is that, an assimilation to Christ. That saying at the end of Gaudium et Spes 24:3 is one of the few sayings of Jesus reported in all four Gospels, twice in Matthew and Luke. So it's fundamental. And immediately before that saying, in Matthew, Mark, and Luke, in Luke 9, Jesus talks about discipleship, denying oneself, taking up one's cross, following after him. So the law of losing and finding, which he formulates as a general law of the life of persons, is an explanation of that discipleship. I think that deep Trinitarian and Christological background is what one has to keep in mind when one reads what John Paul II has to say about the gift of self in the theology of the body, in light of Gaudium et Spes 24:3. It's interesting that with Jean Danielou, Wojtyła had the responsibility of producing an early draft of Gaudium et Spes at a crucial point in the history of its composition. He may well be responsible for the paragraph containing the two laws of the life of persons. At any rate, you find those two laws already some years before the council in Love and Responsibility. Those are lectures Wojtyła delivered in 57 to 59 and published in 1960. Gaudium et Spes was promulgated 5 years later, 5 years after the publication of Love and Responsibility. There's one passage in particular that I want to point to in Love and Responsibility, and I quote, "One person can give himself or herself, can surrender entirely to another, whether to a human person or to God. And such a giving of the self creates a special form of love, which we define as spousal love. This fact goes to prove that the person has a dynamism of its own, and that specific laws govern its existence and evolution. So he's laying hold of certain laws that govern the life and evolution of the person. Christ gave expression to this in a saying which is on the face of it profoundly paradoxical. He who would save his soul shall lose it, and he who would lose his soul for my sake shall find it. And then immediately after that follows a reflection on the first of the two principles in Gaudium et Spes. Indeed, the problem of spousal love does contain a profound paradox, a very real and not merely a verbal paradox. The words of the gospel point to a concrete reality, and the truth which they contain is made manifest in the life of the person. Thus, of its very nature, a person cannot be transferred or ceded to another. In the natural order, it is oriented toward self-perfection, toward the attainment of an ever greater fullness of existence, which is, of course, always the existence of some concrete I. We've already stated that the self-perfection proceeds side by side with love. The fullest, the most uncompromising form of love, still continuing the quote, consists precisely in self-giving, in making one's inalienable and non-transferable I someone else's property. This is doubly paradoxical. Firstly, in that it is possible to step outside one's own I in this way, and secondly, in that the I, far from being destroyed or impaired as a result, is enlarged and enriched, of course, in a superphysical, a moral sense. The gospel stresses this very clearly and unambiguously. Would lose, shall find again. Would save, shall lose. You will readily see that we have here not merely the personalistic norm, but also bold and explicit words of advice which make it possible for us to amplify and elaborate on that norm. The world of persons possesses its own laws of existence and of development. So very clearly in this text, you have the articulation of two laws of the life of persons. One, the personalistic norm, which is each of us, because we know the good and love it, pursue it. We pursue our perfection. And we are to be loved by others in accord with that nature which makes us persons in the first place. And then the second law, that we only find ourselves when we give up that life. Marriage at the beginning is a joyful gift. During married life, it's a joyful gift too. But the saying at the end is about the cross. So death is included in that gift. The interesting thing is that this passage in Love and Responsibility shows that the two laws, although they stand at opposite ends of the life of person, aren't unrelated. The law of the gift, he says, amplifies and elaborates on the personalistic norm. The two laws concern one single reality, namely the life of the person, first in its beginnings and potential in human nature, then in its full realization in relation to the divinized love of the members of Christ to come to share in the life of Christ and the Trinity. So that makes a little bit clearer why he can say Gaudium et Spes 24:3 contains the whole truth about man. The beginning and the end, the natural order and its supernatural fulfillment, they're both embraced by those two laws. And the middle is covered as well. That is, This holds for every phase of life, these two fundamental principles. That was personalism number one, Trinitarian personalism of self-gift. And you find those articulations exactly in St. John of the Cross. When you study Kant, it's very interesting, one place to turn, that when I turned to it for the first time, which wasn't long ago, was absolutely astonished and thrilled, because so much comes together. Kant's treatment of sex. The great philosopher of Königsberg also considered that. He never married, but he considered it. This is a passage in the Metaphysics of Morals. The natural use that one sex makes of the sexual organs of the other is an enjoyment for which one partner gives himself or herself to the other. It's very interesting. You notice immediately the presence of the word enjoyment, and in Love and Responsibility, where Tuva argues you can't just enjoy a person, that is, derive pleasure from them, use them as a means for pleasure, but it has to be an authentic gift of self. Both of those notions are in the very first sentence here, Kant's treatment of sexual union. So the natural use that one sex makes of the sexual organs of the other is an enjoyment for which one partner gives himself or herself to the other. In this act, a human being makes himself into a thing, which is contrary to the right of human nature to one's own person. Right, you have a right to your own person because you are self-determining. But in sexual intercourse, you let yourself be handled and taken by somebody else. That's contrary to your dignity. It's contrary to the right you have to yourself. This is possible, he explains then, how you can nevertheless do this. Under one single condition, when a person is acquired by another in a manner equal to a thing, correspondingly the former acquires the latter by a marriage contract. For in this way, the person gains itself back and reconstitutes its personhood. Now, the acquisition of one bodily member of a human being is at the same time an acquisition of the whole person, because the person is an absolute unity. So once again, for Kant, sexual intercourse is a gift of self contrary to the dignity of the person. In all sexual relations, whether in marriage or outside it, both persons turn themselves into mere things by giving their sexual organs and therefore their whole persons to each other for the sake of being possessed and enjoyed. And being used in such a way is contrary to the autonomy of the person, contrary to the right the person has to himself, because persons should be treated as ends and not as means. Kant writes in another place, while man is unholy enough, the humanity in his person must be holy to him. In all of creation, everything one might want and over which one has power can be used as a mere means. Only man himself, and with him every rational creature, is end in itself. For in virtue of the autonomy of his freedom, he is the subject of the moral law, which is holy. The only remedy for turning yourself into a thing sexually, according to Kant, is marriage. Because by marriage, I permanently acquire my spouse as a thing. I thereby offset the loss of myself to her as a thing when she enjoys me sexually. By a permanent contract, I own the one who episodically owns me, and in that way, I regain myself and my autonomy. So it's like a man who wants to gamble but is afraid of losing his money, so he buys the casino. When he loses the money, he gets it back because he owns the house. The personalistic norm, as Kant understands it, is equivalent to the categorical imperative, which is act in such a way that at any time the maxim of your will can at the same time be valid as a principle of universal legislation. By acting according to the categorical imperative, Kant holds, I grasp my own dignity as an autonomous person who is self-moving in the most radical manner possible, namely as the universal lawgiver for all persons. In this autonomy, one must see the moral humanity in oneself as the only thing that has absolute value, the only final end of the entire cosmos. It immediately follows that I have to affirm the dignity of others as well. You can't be consistent with yourself in affirming your own dignity as a universal lawgiver if you don't grant the same dignity to others. So in the actual application, Kant's personalistic norm works much like the golden rule in the teaching of Jesus. Do to others as you would have them do to you. In everything, do to others as you would have them do to you. That's the Matthean version. For this is the law and the prophets. But the similarity goes hand in hand with a profound opposition between Kant and the gospel. And that opposition becomes apparent when you examine what his argument for the personalistic norm, which we already touched on, but just to get it out again, a person must not be merely the means to an end for another person. This is precluded by the very nature of personhood, by what a person is. For a person is a thinking subject and capable of taking decisions. These, most notably, are the attributes we find in the inner self of a person. This being so, every person is by nature capable of determining his or her aims. Anyone who treats a person as the means to an end does violence to the very essence of the other, to what constitutes its natural right. You'll notice that this argument is based on rational nature, that is, on the capacity to understand the good, to understand aims, ends, and pursue them. In Kant, the point is not that the person can understand and pursue the good and ends, but that the person is the ultimate end of the cosmos in virtue of autonomy. And so Wojtyła writes, Immanuel Kant formulated the following imperative, act always in such a way that the other person is the end and not merely the instrument of your action. In the light of the preceding argument, this principle should be restated in a form rather different from that which Kant gave it as follows. Whenever a person is the object of your activity, remember that you may not treat that person as only a means to an end, as an instrument, but must allow for the fact that he or she too has, or at least should have, distinct personal ends. So that's really different. The difference is between having an end and being the highest good. Being the highest good differs from being the beneficiary of the highest good. Being God differs from having God. Interesting, Aristotle observes in the Ethics that if and only if man were the highest being, practical knowledge would be the supreme form of knowledge. And there he seems to be describing Kant exactly. To sum up, the key to Kant's personalism is the absolutizing of the autonomous dignity of the person as the highest end. The person must be treated as the final end, not as a means. John Paul's understanding of the personalistic norm is opposed to Kant on exactly this point. It's closer to Aristotle's and St. Thomas's account of the love of friendship, according to which persons have ends, And the right way to treat them is to love them and will the good for them, for their own sake. You see that in some way Kant's personalism is built on the first of the two principles of Gaudium et Spes 24:3, though on a very different understanding of it than Wojtyła's. Scheler's personalism is built on the second principle, but again, a very different understanding of it. It's difficult to imagine two thinkers who are further apart from each other than Kant and Scheler. It's true that both belong to the trajectory of the philosophy of consciousness from Descartes through Kant, Hegel, and so on. But it's no accident that Kant stems from the Protestant North and Scheler from the Catholic South of Germany, an origin not erased even by his spectacular apostasy from the Catholic faith toward the end of his life. Hansus von Balthasar shows in his account of Scheler's personalism, there are about 100 pages on Scheler in his first work, Apokalypse der deutschen Seele, that according to Scheler, the highest and most perfect form of love is God's self-giving love as revealed by Jesus. According to Scheler, one can see a radical reversal in the basic movement of love when one compares Plato's and Aristotle's understanding of love with the Christian understanding of love. In Plato and Aristotle, love has an ascending movement of longing for fulfillment, fulfillment at the end by the infinite good that constitutes the goal or object of human striving. But in Christianity, according to Scheler, all attention is focused on the descending love of God, in which fullness comes first and self-gift is a necessary overflow. Brother Scheler wrote before Anders Nygren and his famous book Agape and Eros. Nygren probably read Scheler, I assume. You can find exactly the same opposition in Anders Nygren. This is how Balthasar summarizes Scheler's position. It was only in this lavish self-gift in freedom that the self-glory and highest sovereignty of this love, neither bound by anything nor obliged to anything, was revealed. Once this reversal in the movement of love has been initiated by Christ, it becomes the true access to the supreme value. It is only in performing this act of bending down, in letting himself glide down, in losing himself, that man can gain the supreme value, becoming like God. Most of these are quotes actually from Scheler. This is a little tapestry of quotes from Scheler. It is all the more surprising to Scheler that the intellectual and philosophical expression of this singular revolution of the human spirit failed in an almost incomprehensible manner. You see, it's in Scheler's judgment a revolution that gets you from the first of the two principles of Gaudium et Spes 24:3 to the second. You reject the first and you opt for the second. That's the point. It was precisely the Platonic definition of love as striving that passed over into scholastic philosophy, contrary to the innermost intentions of Christianity, so that, quote, this is a very important quote from Scheler, there never was, or at best were only weak beginnings of, a philosophical understanding of the world and of life that sprang originally and spontaneously from the Christian experience. It was Scheler's ambition to supply that kind of philosophy. Can you imagine Wojtyła's attraction to Scheler coming from St. John of the Cross, filled with the notion of gift of self in St. John of the Cross, with a sensitivity for the subjectivity of the person? Scheler must have been electrical for him and fascinating to get into. Schiller notes that his ethics, quote, presupposes Kant's destruction of Greek and scholastic forms of ethics, and therefore the destruction of the personalistic norm as what Tiwa understands it or explains it. One must treat the person as having an end, because that implies the Greek understanding of eros. One of Scheler's concerns, as he spells out what this revolution in the concept of love means, is to respond against Nietzsche's objections against Christianity, according to which Christian love is born of the resentment of the weak against the strong. So the argument is that a lack of vitality makes Christians unable to enjoy life, and so out of resentment, they transmute weakness and wretchedness into virtues. Scheler's answer is that Christian love is free of resentment because it's a movement of free giving out of fullness. It's a selfless descent from the heights of perfection to the depths. Here's one quote that states that aspect of Scheler's view very clearly. What does the bourgeois man who wants to become something and who secretly measures himself by his lords and kings, even when he rebels against them? What could he know of voluntary self-abasement, of the sweet urge of pouring oneself out, felt by those who are something, the noble, who do not see themselves as standing at the heights precisely because they do, as a matter of fact, stand on the heights? Humility, this is precisely the movement of self-abasement, the movement of coming down from above, of coming from the height of God, letting himself glide down to humanity, of the Holy One to the sinner. This free, daring, fearless movement of a spirit whose fullness, a fullness possessed as a matter of course, makes it impossible for him even to understand the concept of lavishly giving oneself away and squandering oneself. Now, Scheler's work is incredibly rich and varied. His personalism could be unfolded in many directions. Balthasar's study of those 100 pages is a masterpiece of gathering them up. For example, Scheler has a profound understanding of solidarity based on Dostoevsky's Brothers Karamazov, and that much inspired John Paul II's social thought and action. You remember Solidarność, the union movement. Scheler has a deep understanding of the person's consciously lived experience, which I think deepened Matthieu's personalism, above all in the acting person. He has fabulous passages on the expression of the person in the body that inspired, I think, parts of John Paul II's account in the Theology of the Body. Scheler's account of shame, sexual shame in particular, is very important for John Paul II. Also, his understanding of the imitation of Christ, evident particularly in his discussion of St. Francis of Assisi. So you could mention many, many, many examples of positive influence where Wojtyła was able to take something positive from Scheler. But in this one point, descending from absolute fullness, love as essentially gift only without desire, on that point, there's a radical opposition. In his habilitation thesis in moral theology on Scheler, Wojtyła chose as his point of departure Scheler's teaching on the imitation of Christ. And the main question he raises is, can we, or to what degree can we, attempt to interpret Christian ethics with the help of Scheler's system? That book hasn't been translated into English, unfortunately. There was a project of doing it, but nothing came of the project. So all kinds of completely unfounded claims are made about the relation between Scheler and Wojtyła. So in raising this question, can we use Scheler's system to interpret Christian ethics? Wojtyła meets Scheler at a point that's not incidental, but deeply embedded in Scheler's own intentions. Scheler attempts to de-Hellenize and de-scholastify philosophy in order to reach, for the first time in the history of philosophy, the personalist philosophical understanding of the world that springs originally and spontaneously from the Christian experience of self-giving love. And so the question, can we use his system as a basis for moral theology, is a very appropriate question. It's exactly what Scheler wanted to do, in a way. It's interesting that, I find this slightly ironic, that in structuring his argument, Wojtyła follows Aristotle's four causes, minus matter. That's the four parts of the book. Chapter one of the thesis gives a preliminary overview. Chapter two examines Scheler's account of the formal cause of moral goodness, moral value. Chapter three, his account of the efficient cause, the acting person. And chapter four, his account of the final cause. What's the end of moral action? I find this Aristotelian structure of the overall argument somewhat pointed in a book about a philosopher whose project it was to free Christian philosophy from Greek and medieval thought, particularly Aristotle. Let's look just at the very end of Wojtyła's argument, which deals with God as the end of the moral life, because at that point of the argument is most relevant to the main thrust of Scheler's personalism, which opposes agape to eros, self-giving love out of fullness as opposed to the striving love of Greek philosophy, especially Plato and Aristotle, which contaminated Christian philosophy. Scheler agrees with Kant that happiness can't be the goal of moral goodness. But happiness, of course, understood very differently than the Greeks. Happiness understood as a form of joy or pleasure rather than a life about which you can say it is good. Yet while Kant locates happiness far from the core of the person, as the irrational object of sensual inclinations, Scheler gives to happiness the most central possible place in the human spirit as the source of all morally good acts. It's an example of Scheler seeing where Kant is and then going as far as he can away from him. I'm quoting Scheler now. Deepest happiness and complete bliss are dependent in their being on a consciousness of one's own moral goodness. Only the good person is blissful. This does not preclude the possibility that this very blissfulness is the root and source of all willing and acting. But happiness can never be a goal or even a purpose of willing and acting. Only the happy person acts in a morally good way. Happiness is therefore in no way a reward for virtue, and there he quotes Aristotle, nor is virtue the means to reach bliss. Rather, happiness is the root and source of virtue, a fountainhead, although it is only a consequence of the inner goodness of the person. The innermost source of bliss, according to Scheler, in the Catholic period, is a participation in the divine nature when one acts in God. And such a participation in the divine nature in the moral act is an unsurpassable fountain of unsurpassable bliss. No reward in the afterlife could equal that bliss. Again from Sheila, in his existence and his acts, the good person directly takes part in the nature of God in the sense of velle in Deo, or amare in Deo. And he is blissful in this participation. A reward from God could only put a smaller and lower good in place of a higher one, and a superficial feeling in the place of a deeper pleasure. Wittima points out that it's difficult to reconcile this understanding of unsurpassable bliss with the teaching of the Gospels, just the reading we had for today in Mass, which talked about the reward. So the teaching of the Gospels on reward and punishment, in which bliss understood as the union with God, beatific vision, is promised as a reward, not pointed out as an existing reality. Here now is Wittima. We see that in the teaching of Revelation, all emphasis in the doctrine of eternal blessedness falls on the object of blessedness, namely the divine nature, which is this object. In Scheler's phenomenological system, of course, this doctrine cannot be grasped and expressed. We could talk about that, why that's impossible for Scheler to affirm that it's the bracketing of real being is the problem. No good that comes from outside the person can be a greater good than the good which the person finds in himself when he experiences himself as the source of a morally good act. Still continuing, quoting Wojtyła, the greatest happiness and the greatest suffering, man draws these from within himself. He himself is its source for himself. This point of view separates us completely from the Christian teaching. Given such a point of view, can we establish any point of contact with the revealed truth, according to which the object of man's final blessedness is the divine nature? And in the end, Wittima answers, no. A personalism in which human love is a free descent from inner fullness and joy, a pure gift love, is irreconcilable with Christian faith. Let me summarize the points on Scheler. Scheler, like Kant, attributes a quasi-divine value to the human person. That seems to be the problem in both cases. The excess seems to be due in part to his concern to answer Nietzsche's attack on Christianity, to protect Christianity from Nietzsche's charge that it transmutes weakness and suffering into virtue. Scheler paints a quasi-divine picture of the human person. The key to his personalism is the bliss of the morally good person who experiences his own individual value essence as an absolute fullness. It's bliss without need, with no desire for a divine reward. The person already has the final end within himself and descends to other human beings from this fullness in purely self-giving love. And so, like Kant's personalism, Scheler's personalism is anti-Trinitarian. The dependence and receptivity implied in sonship doesn't play a constitutive role. I'm at the end of the talk, so there are only a few more lines. John Paul II's personalism is built on the law of the life of persons expressed by Vatican II in Gaudium et Spes 24.3. Kant's personalism is built on a principle apparently similar, but in fact profoundly opposed to the first principle of Gaudium et Spes 24.3, the personalistic norm, the absolute moral dignity of the human person as an autonomous agent is, according to Kant, the unsurpassable final end of the whole cosmos. Scheler's personalism is built on a principle apparently similar to, but in fact profoundly opposed to, the second principle of Gaudium et Spes 24.3, the law of the gift. So you see, you can construct even a history of philosophy around Gaudium et Spes 24.3. What's the logic of development from Kant to Scheler? Gaudium et Spes 24.3. answer. It's difficult to conceive a disagreement that's more radical and fundamental than that disagreement between John Paul II on the one side and Kant as well as Scheler on the other. The final end, you could say, determines everything. A personalism for which God is the final end differs radically and fundamentally from personalisms in which the final end is already found within the human person. In that way, John Paul II's personalism is much closer to the personalism of Greek and medieval philosophy and theology, particularly Plato, Aristotle, St. Bonaventure, St. Thomas. In one of his essays where Thibaut refers to himself as we in the Thomistic school, and I think we can take him at his word, but this important proviso, he encountered St. Thomas first in St. John of the Cross. Thanks very much.
Thank you, Dr. Waldstein, for a very illuminating lecture and a lot to think about, and I hope you'll take a few questions.
Happily.
Okay, anyone would like to comment or ask a question about this account of three personalisms? Dr. Oliva.
Thank you. Would you welcome in this hermeneutics of the gift also the idea of givenness of being developed in the contemporary continental philosophy, especially in Heidegger, in Jean-Luc Marion, in Gadamer? So would you say that the givenness of being that Heidegger defends could be compatible with this hermeneutics of the gift?
Yes. I'm very attracted to Hans-Urs von Balthasar's reading of Heidegger, which is a very positive one, as a retrieval of antiquity in some way. But at the same time, yeah. So a retrieval of antiquity in which the marvel of being and its beauty is a source of endless wonder. But it's also undeniable that Heidegger is a post-Christian thinker who definitely leaves behind what he believed as a Jesuit seminarian when he was one, and then when he became a Protestant, and then eventually a post-Christian. So the full sense of gift as coming from love isn't there, just as it wasn't there in the Greeks. But something close to it is there. It's more like the bonum diffusivum sui in the sense of an impersonal principle, or Aristotle's ripe fruit that makes another like itself. Although Heidegger dismisses all of that as ontotheology, I'm not sure that that's a just charge against the Greeks. But so that's. In German, I would say my answer is jein, which combines yes and no.
I agree.
I have to admit that as much Kant as I've read, I'd never read that stunning statement about
Isn't
sex.
It? Yeah,
never.
It's fabulous.
But it certainly follows.
Yeah.
And, you know, could you comment on its possible life into post-modernity? I mean, post-modernity seems to think it can have sex if it can't have anything else. Kant seems to suggest that no, even that, you know, if we're locked inside of our own heads, we're going to lose.
Right. Yeah. There's a lot of thinking, of course, among feminist authors on the relation between sex and power. And that is explicitly there in Kant, because sex is always empowering oneself of another person as if it were a thing and making it serve your own purposes. So this interpretation of sex in terms of power, that's a theme that seems to have become very fruitful. I don't know if they read, Michel Foucault, for example, studied that text in Kant for his own work on sex. That I don't know. Anybody who has read that book of Michel Foucault, and yeah, do you remember him talking about Kant at all? No? Yeah. What Kant says is also in some ways parallel in an opposite way to pop culture, to our pop culture, in which there's easy and uncomplicated, except by disease, enjoyment of the body of the opposite sex without gift. And so we in our pop culture in a way verify what Kant saw as a general rule. But not really verify, because what escaped Kant is a point that John Paul II makes repeatedly, namely that inescapably sexual intercourse speaks the gift. That's inescapable. You can't eradicate that. I remember reading an article in the New York Times by somebody who was reflecting about the sexual revolution and who was saying that the sexual revolution never was really finished. Why not? Because he never met a woman who simply enjoyed sex just for the enjoyment of it. They always wanted something from him afterwards. Not money, but him. They wanted some kind of relationship. So that's, I found that an eloquent testimony to the ineradicability of what John Paul II calls the speech of the body or the language of the body in the sexual act. I'm yours and you're mine. That is the gift of self. That's so deep in us that it can't be taken out. That Kant doesn't see this at all is, I mean, he must have read a little bit about love, but.
I don't really need that, but that's okay. Thank you very much. It was a wonderful lecture. I do.
Thanks.
I would like to ask you a question. You have distinguished Wotia from Kant and Shaler, it seems to me, in an extraordinary way. I have a practical question. During John Paul II's pontificate and right now, the issue of capital punishment has come up. Most secular thinkers who are opposed to capital punishment are opposed to it on precisely Kantian grounds and on the sort of divinization of the individual self, and therefore capital punishment is not acceptable. Now, we all know that John Paul II, to some degree, moved the church in an anti-capital punishment direction, although it's still not clear to a lot of people how far he went. Mm-hmm. My question is, you've emphasized the differences between Kant and John Paul II, but on this issue, would they actually draw the same conclusion?
Right. It's true that coming from the personalism of St. John of the Cross, Wojtyła felt in some way much more at ease with modernity than many pontiffs before him whose roots were more immediately and totally Thomistic. I think that's true. Whether John Paul II thought of this as... So I think there's an attitude in him of genuine openness in gathering up logoi, spermaticoi that are really there. He picks those up gladly. You never sense any resentment against Kant or Scheler. They're not his opponents, the way Kant was an opponent for Scheler. I think that needs to be said. There's perhaps an element of diplomacy in here as well, that the lingua franca of our political discourse is Kantian liberalism. And the church has been speaking that lingua franca for quite a while now, since Vatican II, whereas it refused to speak that lingua franca in some of the pontiffs before. In the case of capital punishment, I have to punt, if I may. I don't know clearly enough, that is, I haven't studied the details of his own position compared with a position based simply on the dignity of personal autonomy and those who are capable of choice. That is a pro-choice rejection of capital punishment. My sense from reading what I did read about it is, given his strong defense of life in other areas, he felt he should also say something here. That's my sense. But that's more a punt than a real account. So I would have to study that question or defer to somebody who studied it. Maybe you studied it.
I'm punting too.
You're punting too. Okay. The football game ends on a downward note.
Let's take the touchdowns you've scored and call it an evening. Thank you,
okay.
Dr. Waldstein.
Thanks very much.
Thank you.